My talk is on acidic sequences and Roussy fractals. I just want to give you a brief outline of what I'm going to do. So let S be a set of substitutions. Let's say it's a finite set, but it doesn't really matter. It's important that all the substitutions are defined over the same alphabet. And then we build a sequence of substitutions taken from this set S. And I'm interested in words that can be written as such a limit. So you take one letter and you iterate the substitutions on this letter. And if you're lucky, then this limit exists. And if it exists, we call this an acidic sequence. I will later give you a better definition of this, but this is just essentially what it boils down to. Using this word, we wish to define a dynamical system. So let sigma be a shift on AN, and we look at the orbit closure of the acidic word W under this shift, and call this XW. And the pair XW together with the shift, equipped with the shift or the restriction of the shift to XW, this is called the acidic shift. And we would like to understand under what conditions, as general as possible, is this acidic shift measurably conjugate to a rotation on the torus. Turns out that D minus 1 is the dimension of the torus that is best suited. So motivated is what we are doing is motivated by some older results. So you probably all know the Sturmian sequence. So a Sturmian sequence is a sequence of a two-letter alphabet whose complexity function is given by pw of n is n plus 1. So this means that the word has n plus 1 subwords of length n. And one can prove that Sturmian sequences are examples of acidic sequences, namely they can be generated by those two substitutions, sigma and tau, and the reason why they can be generated in this way is that they enjoy some balance properties. So the first people who systematically studied Sturmian sequences, so they go back to, I think, to Bernoulli or so rather far. So a systematic study is contained in two papers by Morse and Hedlund, as well as Coven and Hedlund, 1940, 1972. And essentially, they proved that if W is a Sturmian sequence, then this acidic system is measurably conjugate to the one torus. So here we have two letters, and this means 2 minus 1 is 1, so we are just on the circle. Another single example for a higher dimensional or more letter case I want to present you. This goes back to 1982 and was done by Roussy. So he considered a single substitution, so the set capital S I introduced just as a single element, and you iterate this single substitution on one letter, and it turns out that what you get out is an infinite word, so this nicely converges, and you can look at this orbit closure. So again, define the associated substitutive dynamical system. And what Roussy proved that in this particular case, this dynamical system is measurably conjugate to a rotation on the torus. So this is a single example, and now we want to generalize this. Before we do this, I just want to give you not even an idea, but just a picture on, or two pictures on how Roussy proved this. So what he did is, if you look at this word, you can associate with each of the letters one coordinate direction in R3. So 1 is the first base vector, 2 is the second base vector, and 3 is the third base vector. And then using this infinite word, you can build up a broken line. Whenever you read 1, you go in this direction. When you read 2, you go in this direction. When you read 3, you go in this direction. What you get is a broken line, and I visualize this broken line here. It turns out that this broken line has several good properties. What is essential for us is that it stays at bounded distance to some vector u, and the coordinates of u are rationally independent. And so what you do now is you take the corner points of this broken line, not the whole edges, just the vertices, and project it down along U to some hyperplane, or to some plane in this case. And it turns out, when you take the closure of this projection, you get a compact set. And this compact set can be subdivided in three subsets, according to which letter you were reading before you projected. And this nice object that you get now bears the name of Rossi. It's called the Rossi fractal. So this is the mother of all Rossi fractals, the classical Rossi fractal. And now the idea of Rossi was, so we want to see the rotation on this Rossi fractal. And he was able to prove several nice properties of this fractal. Among others, he showed that so these subtiles, they permit a domain exchange. So if so this is the subtile corresponding to the letter 1, 2, and 3. And if you shift those three guys, then again you get the same Rossi fractal. And so this shifting sort of is one step on the broken line. Using this, the first thing he could do is he could show that the original dynamical system is measurably conjugate to this domain exchange. And now this is very nice. So this induces a tiling, a lattice tiling of the plane. And now, if you factor out the lattice, so then this Rossi fractal nicely wraps around the torus. And even more nice, so when you wrap this around the torus, then this domain exchange just becomes a rotation. And this is the rotation you want to get. So this was the very nice idea of Rossi. And what we want to do is we want to use the same idea in our more general setting. So Rossi only had one substitution, and he only had one single example. In the meantime, this was generalized more and more. But mainly, it was generalized to cases where the set capital S contained only one substitution. So this, we call this the substitutive case. And what we did is we went one step further, and we did it for S80 sequences in the sense I defined on the first slide. So what do we need? So my main aim here is I just take out some part of the proof that we had to conduct. I'm talking about the Rossi fractal and about how our Rossi fractals have the properties under certain conditions that are needed. So our aim is we want to see the rotation we are conjugate to on some Rossi fractal, which is not yet defined. And this Rossi fractal should be subdivided into subtiles, each one corresponding to the letter. Think of this broken line. So we also will have a broken line in our general setting. And what we want is we want this guy to be bounded. It is closed by definition. I hope I said this. So we take the closure of the projection. But even more, we would like this guy to be topologically nice. So it should be the closure of its interior. And the boundary should have measure zero, so there should not be considerable overlaps, because if we have overlaps, then our domain exchange is not defined with problems there. As I also mentioned, this R should be the fundamental domain of a lattice, so we can again wrap it around a torus, and this is how we want to get our rotation. So it turns out that all these conditions here, so we are able to prove this under fairly general.
When you say rotation here, do you mean a toral automorphism, or is it really somehow?
It's a rotation of the torus. It's x plus alpha modulo the lattice. Yeah. So these properties we can define in a fairly general setting. To make sure that R is a fundamental domain, we need some additional combinatorial conditions that have to be checked. We want to get rid of this. We are working on this. But so far, the only general thing is what we can do is if we project R on the torus, it is m to 1 for some m greater or equal to 1. The hassle is to prove that m is equal to 1. But fortunately, these combinatorial conditions can be checked for several classes. I will come back to this later. So I promised you to give a good definition of S80 sequence. So what is an S80 sequence? So W, so you take a sequence of substitutions, fixed sequence of substitutions over an alphabet A. So all the substitutions are defined on the same alphabet. And a sequence W is called a limit sequence or an SADIC sequence, if you can desubstitute it, so here is your W, then you can write your W as sigma zero of another W, which is W1, and you can write it as sigma zero, sigma one of W2, and so on and so on. So you can desubstitute it, okay? This is a general definition of SADIC sequence. This is a bit more awkward than the limit I wrote up, but fortunately, posing a mild condition, which we need anyway on our sequence of substitutions, this limit, we can make sure that this limit exists. But anyway, this is the general definition. So we have to iterate substitutions, we have to form iterations of substitutions, and for this reason I want to introduce this notation. So for a block of substitutions, so this is sigma L minus 1 applied to sigma L applied and so on, and then at the end we apply sigma K. This is just abbreviated by sigma from K to L. Here we have a round bracket because it only goes to L minus 1. And I think we already saw incidence matrices in several talks, at least in one talk I have in my mind. So I don't have to define the incidence matrix, it's just, it's so to say, it's the abelianization of the substitution. It forgets the order of the letters, it just acts from Zn to Zn, which is what is important for us. And also for the incidence matrices, the products are abbreviated by this. I will use this notation now and then. So I told you that we need some conditions to make things work, and so some of these conditions can be defined not on the substitutions but just on the incidence matrices. One important thing is primitivity. So primitivity is equivalent to the minimality of the system, of the SADIC system. That's why we need primitivity, and we will always assume that we have primitivity. A sequence of substitutions is primitive if wherever you start you can find the block which is positive. And if a sequence is primitive, then we can write our SADIC words nicely. So then we get these limits and we don't need the more awkward definition that I give you. So W just comes from iterating this sequence of substitutions on a letter. And it's even better. So if we take different limit words, it turns out that there are at most cardinality of the alphabet many limit words. It doesn't matter which limit word we take, we always get the same shift. And so what I will do in the sequel for this reason is I will just write x boldface sigma instead of xw boldface sigma. I did not indicate it. Boldface sigma is just this sequence here. So our shift just depends on the sequence of substitutions, and it can be defined also in terms of languages. It is the set of all infinite sequences whose language coincides with the language of any limit word, which is the same as saying it corresponds, it coincides with this language, okay? So what else do we need if you remember the picture I gave you? So one important thing was that our Rossi fractal stays close to some expanding line. And even more, later we want to subdivide this Rossi fractal and we want the sub pieces to become smaller and smaller. And for all this we need some convergence properties. There are three properties. I will not go into the formulas. I will show you a picture later, which explains it much better. Weak convergence. This assures you that you have this vector U, where you want your broken line to wrap around. Strong convergence. This ensures you that you can subdivide your Z fractal in a canonical way defined in terms of the substitutions, so that the sub-pieces get smaller and smaller. So what we want to do here is the following. In the substitutive case, your Rossi fractals are self-affine sets. In our case, this is no longer the case. So we need to find some way to mimic self-affinity, and for this reason, this strong convergence is of importance. This can be quantified. So if strong convergence is very fast, then we say we are exponentially convergent. What does it mean? So the weak convergence means that if we hit the base vectors with our matrix products, then on the unit circle, we tend to one direction. This is the weak convergence. Strong convergence means that on the endpoints of these longer and longer vectors, by primitivity they get longer and longer, on the end of these vectors we get closer and closer to U. And of course strong convergence is stronger than weak convergence. Exponential convergence just tells you that this convergence here is exponentially fast. So if we have weak convergence, then we have such a vector U, and this is just some terminology. We call this vector U the generalized right eigenvector. So this is the direction where the broken line in the ideal case wraps around. Of course, we need to make sure that this really happens, but this is the first thing. So yeah, this is clear. The generalized eigenvector is just the analog of the Perron-Fabrinus eigenvector in the single matrix case. So now it took us quite some time to find good conditions that we have to pose on our sequence of matrices. And it turns out that this condition on the Lyapunov exponent that I write here is a good condition. So I define a Lyapunov exponent now for a single sequence. So here's the sequence of matrices. These are, in our case, always incidence matrices of a substitution, so we don't need the substitution here. Then delta I of n is the ith singular value of this matrix product, and the ith Lyapunov exponent is defined as this limit, provided it exists. And what we want is, we want that the second Lyapunov exponent is less than zero. This is this will entail exponential convergence. This property has been studied by Valéry and Vincent Delacroix, and also by Avila and Delacroix, and they found out that this condition is satisfied for some well-known classes of matrices in a generic sense. So what are the consequences of this condition? So if our sequence of substitution satisfies the generalized Pissot condition and is primitive, I think primitivity we need on top of this. Yes, I always assume primitivity. Then the language associated with sigma has balance properties. So what does this mean? This means if you take two words of the same length of this language, then the number of occurrences of each letter in both of the sequences is roughly the same. This can be interpreted geometrically, which I will come back to the geometric interpretation on the next slide. So with balance properties, but I can say it in advance, this implies that our broken line stays at bounded distance of the direction u, and this will assure us that our Rossi fractal is compact, closed by definition, and bounded. The second thing we get is that for each k, there is n greater than k, so that the block kn is irreducible. And this irreducibility is important for us because essentially this is responsible for the fact that the coordinates of the generalized eigenvector u of sigma are rationally independent. And it is quite easy to see if you don't have this rational independence, if you project down along u, you only project vertices of the broken line, you only project vectors with integer coordinates. So if this vector is not rationally independent, you have no hope to get inner points. So this is an important property. And the next thing by this hyperbolicity property of the Lyapunov exponents, sigma converges exponentially and hence also strongly to the vector u. So here is again the picture. Balance, I told you that two segments of the same length of the broken line have each letter, contain each letter roughly the same number of times. This guarantees you that you really stay in bounded distance of u. And as I said before, rational independence of the direction of the projection essentially implies you need a little bit more that you have inner points in the Rossi fractal. So the other implication is a real implication, but this is not interesting for us. This is the main ingredient for the existence of inner points. So now I talked a lot about the Rossi fractal. I gave you a definition by way of a picture. So here's the formal definition, but of course you can guess it from the picture. What did I do here? So for a vector, I just take the orthogonal hyperplane by this notation. And I equip this d minus one dimensional hyperplane with a Lebesgue measure, which I don't need in this definition, I think. But anyway, it doesn't hurt to define it. So now the Rossi fractal. I define the Rossi fractal for a limit word. So I should define it for a sequence of substitutions, probably. But so for simplicity, just let's assume that this sequence of substitution gives us a unique limit word. So it's just the same. The truth is that we can choose any limit word. But anyway, so the Rossi fractal for such a word is just defined by so taking all the prefixes. This L just is the Abelianization map. So this turns a prefix into a vertex of the broken line. So this is the nth vertex of the broken line. And then you project this nth vertex of the broken line on your hyperplane. This is just what I did in the picture. And as I said before, for the classical case, you can subdivide this Rossi fractal naturally into subtiles, depending on you have two ways to do this. Depending on the letter that is to come, which I do here, I could also say depending on the last letter I have. So you get two different kinds of subtiles, and they are related to each other by the domain exchange. But only if everything goes right, if all the properties are nice, which is not clear yet. So these are the Rossi fractals, and now we need to make sure that they have good properties. And I want to give you some impression on how to do this. So these Rossi fractals live on a hyperplane, and they even, again, if everything goes right, they tile this hyperplane with respect to some special tiling set. And this tiling set is defined in terms of a discrete hyperplane, which is defined here. And I think we can skip this because we have pictures here. So what we do is the following. We take a plane or a hyperplane in higher dimensions, and we approximate this plane by squares. So I think it's not important to see the exact definition. That there's some literature on this, and we approximate, and we have three different in 3D. We have three different coordinate parallel squares, and we approximate, so we get this nice approximation. If our plane is rational, this is periodic. If the slope is rational, it's periodic. If we have irrationality somewhere, then this is aperiodic. And so in each of these squares, we have so each of these squares we can project onto the plane, then we get a tiling by losanges of the train, of the plane. And now each of these losanges has a control point. And on each of these control points, we center a Rossi fractal. Depending on the color of the losange, a Rossi fractal, or a subtile, I should say, of the type associated with these squares. And in the ideal case, the Rossi fractals that are positioned in this way, they form a tiling, an aperiodic tiling, if our plane has irrational slopes, and a periodic one, if there are rational slopes. Here is terminology. Okay, so this is a patch, if you take finitely many of these pieces. So, and what I told you, so there is a collection of Rossi fractals. We put a Rossi fractal or a subtile at each square of our discrete plane, and I is just the type of the square, X is just some vector, the projection of some lattice point that is close to the plane. This is how it is defined. I also mentioned that we will see that these collections often form tilings And a special role will be played by the collection associated with the plane that is orthogonal to the vector 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, because there we get our periodic tiling, and in this plane we have our Rossi fractal, which is, again in the good case, a fundamental domain of a torus where we will see the rotation. So this is in the classical case, these are the fractals corresponding to Rossi setting, to a special substitutive case. Here everything is nice. You have three subtiles and they form a tiling, so there is no overlap. And those three together, they can be used to create the lattice tiling. So everything is nice in this setting. So we want to get properties of our Rossi fractals, and I already mentioned the difficulty we have. In the substitutive case, you can subdivide the Rossi fractal by using your substitution. And if you do this in the correct way, this was first done by Victor Sirvent and Yang Wang. I don't know exactly when that was, but I think in the around the year 2000. So what you get is that each of your subtiles is a finite union of smaller copies of other subtiles. So this is a graph-directed self-affine set, and the important thing is that this graph is finite. This makes life easy. In our case, we have a problem. So forget the n for the moment. Just look at, think of this as the ordinary Rossi fractal. You can subdivide this ordinary Rossi fractal into translations of smaller, which is not clear if they are really smaller, of copies of Rossi fractals again. But now please look. Don't forget this n now. So here I have n, here I have n plus 1. So if I start with the Rossi fractals associated with the sequence of substitutions sigma 0, sigma 1, sigma 2, I get here the Rossi fractals associated with the shifted sequence. So I don't get self-affinity. Self-affinity is destroyed. And even worse, so these matrices, they are contractions on the hyperplanes where the Rossi fractals live. These matrices are not, but by our Pissot conditions, eventually they become. So we have to be very careful when we do this. These Rossi fractals live in a different hyperplane than these Rossi fractals. So many things break down, and we have to be careful. I just want to give an illustration of the set equation. So these are the Rossi fractals, a patch of the tiling of the Rossi fractals of the original sequence of substitutions. And if we shift, this is the shifted sequence of substitutions. This also induces a tiling, but by fractals that could look different. This is an easy example here. And live in a different hyperplane. So this is illustrated here. We have one plane where the original Rossi fractal lives, and another plane where the Rossi fractals of the shifted sequence lives. And what the set equation says, if you take the shifted sequence, hit it with the matrix M0, then the Rossi fractals you see here should get smaller, or at least eventually smaller, and should subdivide the original Rossi fractals. And I did this here, so I just hit the whole plane here with, I hope this is visible, hit the whole plane with the incidence matrix of the zeroth substitution, first in the sequence, and you see that you get, so this patch that you saw subdivides the Rossi fractals from the previous collection, and so if you look at the whole original patch, then you can subdivide everything. So this is the classical Rossi fractal. Here everything works. So we don't know anything for now. We just know that we have a compact set, but of course this could look very ugly. We need to make sure that we get this nice picture under our conditions. And so here's the first result in this direction. So if sigma satisfies the Pissot condition, then generically, I don't want to go into this, then generically, each subtile is the closure of its interior. So why is this true? This is not very visible here, right? So you see the Rossi fractal, which is subdivided in small pieces. So the main steps in the proof, so we have rational independence of U, so we know that there is an, this is not trivial, but we can prove that there is at least one inner point in Ri, Then the set equation gives us a subdivision. I hope it's a little bit visible here. And strong convergence implies that the diameter of the pieces of the subdivisions gets smaller and smaller. And so this allows us to carry this inner point everywhere. It's not, so this is just very rough. We need to be careful that in these subdivisions the pieces are different from the original pieces, but still now and then they become similar to the original ones, and we can spread the inner points everywhere, and finally we can conclude that this is the closure of the interior. The next step is to prove that the boundary has measure zero. I think this proposition is even needed for the other result, but anyway, so this is an important ingredient. So all these OC fractals live in different planes, and we somehow want to tame them. And what we can do is we can find a subsequence, so that we shift, when we shift our sequence of substitutions by elements of this subsequence, we create OC fractals that are close to the original OC fractal, in the sense that the hyperplanes are close to each other, and also in the sense that the subdivision structure is for a long time the same. This is some kind of recurrence property. So if we sum up under suitable conditions, it's essentially the Pissot condition. So the Pissot condition guarantees that if you define a class of sequences, that this is true almost always. So we have this convergence property. And using this, we do the following. So we want to show that the measure of the boundary is zero. So here is our OC fractal. We subdivide it, and we know that our subpieces get smaller and smaller. And we also know that our original OC fractal contains an inner point. So if we subdivide long enough, we can make sure that one of our pieces is contained in the interior. So it cannot be, has non-empty, non-empty intersection with the boundary, right? And now we know that this cannot contribute to the measure of the boundary. This is really strictly inside. And now we have to look at the other guys outside. And what we do is we just play the same game again. We subdivide and subdivide until in each of the subdivided pieces there is again a smaller piece which is contained in the interior. And the convergence result we gave, this one, this ensures us that essentially always the same happens. So we can do this procedure again and again, and this eats up our measure. And at the end, we can conclude that if sigma satisfies the Pissot condition, then the Lebesgue measure of the boundary is zero. Okay. So after this, this is what we have so far. So again, we want to see the rotation here. The Pissot condition guarantees that this is bounded. It is the closure of its interior. I hope this greenish thing is at least moderately readable. And the boundary of the OC fractal and also of the subtiles has measure zero. So we made sure that all this is okay. And I told you for the overlapping things, for the fact that the OC fractal is a fundamental domain, we need to check certain conditions, so-called coincidence conditions. These are conditions, combinatorial conditions, that need to be checked. So this remains. This is something that has to be done for each class of substitutions you're interested in. And as I told you, we are trying to get rid of this, but so far we have this, so I have to cope with this. And one class where Valerie and her co-authors could prove that these coincidence conditions are satisfied is the class of Arnoux-OC sequences. This is a very interesting class. This was invented by Pierre Arnoux and Gérard Rossi in 1991. So what they wanted to do is, they wanted to give an analog of Stumian sequences for three letters. And they were hoping that the Thue-Morse results can be carried over, because this is quite analogous in the definition. So what is an Arnoux-OC sequence? It is a sequence over three letters which has low complexity and only one right and one left special factor. So let's forget about this. So it's a sequence over three letters with low complexity, and it turns out that these sequences can be generated by three substitutions in this S-adic limiting way. And this the way they are built is a bit reminiscent of the Sturmian substitutions. So this is the generalization they found, and they conjectured that again there are rotations on the two torus. So what did they do? What is written here? So yes, they found an interesting result. So each ANUR C sequence is the coding of an exchange of six intervals on the circle. Valéry, Jolivet, and CHL, and independently Bach, Stimac, and Williams, they said if U is generated by a periodic sequence of substitutions, which is essentially the same as using, so each block is one substitution, so this is a substitutive case. So you, if you iterate one substitution, which is built up from ANUR C substitutions, then provided that each ANUR C substitution occurs at least once to guarantee the hyperbolicity property. So in this case, this is really, I wrote here, it's a coding of a translation. So then, what I should say here, this is, in our case, this dynamical system, the shift you create with this is conjugate to a translation of the torus again. So if the sequence is periodic, then the life is good. But the question is, what happens if the sequence of substitutions is non-periodic, which is, of course, the generic case. And so the first result that I can report here is due to Cassegna, Ferenczi, and Zamboni. I mentioned the balance property. So the balance of our language is needed in order to keep our broken line close to the expanding direction. Cassegna, Ferenczi, and Zamboni, by a very tricky construction, they found out a sequence of ANUR C substitutions which is not balanced. So this means that the broken line goes farther and farther away. And this can be used to show that there is an ANUR C sequence that is not the natural coding of a translation with bounded fundamental domain. Probably this is not the important thing. The important thing is that you get imbalance, you get some new phenomenon, and this strongly indicates that the theory is no longer true unconditionally for more than two letters, even for this sequence of substitutions that is constructed so nicely. So one needs a little bit more. And what we could do with our general theory was we could rescue at least almost everything. Wait, is this the right result? I need to check if this is what I really want. Yes. So, wait. Yes. So, if we look at the set S of ANUR C substitutions, then for almost all sequences in this full shift here, with respect to some nice measure, the S-adic word gives rise to a dynamical system which is conjugate to a rotation. What is needed to prove this? So the first thing is, I told you about this theory of S-adic Rossi fractals. What we need is, we need the Pissot condition to make it work. For this class, the Pissot condition is provided in this result by Avila and Delacroix. So we have our Pissot condition. The second thing we need is we need to take care of our combinatorial problems. And as I mentioned before, Valéry, Jolivet, and CHL, they made sure that the combinatorial conditions are true as well. And combining all these, we get this almost everywhere result. So the problems indicated by Cassegna and others, they are there, but fortunately they are not so frequent. So the generic case is a better one. And on my last slide, I present you the general result. So if you have a sequence of substitutions, I put finite here, we can relax this, but this is not important. And we look at this shift. This is now a shift on the substitutions, not on the letters. So there are two different shifts, the S-adic shifts and the shift of substitutions. So we take all sequences of substitutions with the shift on it and with an invariant measure. We assume that this is ergodic and satisfies the Pissot condition. We also need some assumption on the measure of the cylinders. We want all cylinders to have positive measure. And also, we want one cylinder with positive incidence matrix. This is needed to guarantee primitivity. If you don't have this, then your system is not minimal. So this is important. And If this is satisfied, then for almost all sequences in this shift here, so if you pick out one sequence of this shift, and this one sequence generates an ascitic shift, which is measured reconjugate to a rotation on the d minus one dimensional torus. And my last remark, so there is a recent result of Masi-Bartsch. So in the substitutive case, under very general conditions, he can show that these combinatorial conditions are in force. And we would like to use this for our ascitic setting to get rid of, wait, did I cheat here? Sorry, I cheated here, something is missing here. No, if the associated subtiles induce a tiling, this condition is needed here, of course. This is the thing that you need to check combinatorially. So we want to get rid of this bad guy here, at least for under mild conditions, by using this result of Masi-Bartsch. This is what we are looking at now, together with Valerie and Wolfgang. So this should be the next step, but so far, this is what I wanted to tell you. Thank you very much for your attention.
So whom can I hand the microphone for the first question?
Need a microphone, apparently. Yeah. is there a combinatorial sufficient condition to imply balancedness in these adic transformations? Because apparently they are not all balanced, because you just showed that, but in some sense, typically, yes. Is there a particular condition that you then need to check or could check?
So, what you have to do is to get this for a class, you have to really go into the combinatorial structure of the words and look what they are doing. So there's no general gadget that tells you if the substitution looks so and so, then you get balance. At least I'm not aware of it, but probably Wolfgang knows more. For particular classes of sequences. But I think you want to know for arbitrary
Is there a kind of encompassing the combinatorial condition that would imply balancedness?
So I'm not aware of this.
In this generic case, is the rotation always the same rotation?
No, it depends on the sequence. And if you look, so all this is a bit related to continued fractions. And if you look at substitutions that are defined in terms of the Brun continued fraction algorithm, so what you do is you put some combinatorial structure on top of the algorithm, of the Brun algorithm, which is not canonical. You define substitutions whose incidence matrices do Brun. Then we can show that almost all rotations on the torus can occur by our shift.
For a given family of...
Yes. Yeah, and what is nice, but not yet proved, so we get a natural coding of these rotations using our ascitic Grossi fractals, and Julien Leroy and Sébastien Labbé, they try to prove that the complexity of these words is linear. And if they would succeed, then we would have a linear coding of for almost all rotations. But this is, as far as I know, it's not yet done. It's still struggling with the combinatorics of these words.
The Arnoux Rosy construction is in a certain sense a generalization of Arnoux Yoko's, where they get a pseudo Anosov. So is there a S-adic family of pseudo Anosov maps that are related to what you're doing, or is this just somewhat similar?
What we try to do, I don't know if this is related, we try to define a flow which has a decent Poincaré section where our continued fraction algorithms work. So this flow is hyperbolic. Is this what you have in mind?
Related, but I think it's different. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of Arnoux Fischer have S-adic families of pseudo-inosuchs.
Yeah, sure, of, yeah, sure, of, sure, right. Sure. Sorry, now I know what you mean. You talk about these mapping families, right?
Yes.
This is related. This is related. And so you can give these Rossi fractals, you can give them a past. You can build a suspension of those. And then they form Markov partitions, non-stationary Markov partitions of these mapping families. And this is related to what I said about these matrices. So the single matrices are non-hyperbolic, but on the long run, you become hyperbolic. So this is Anosov, yes. And so this we already know. So we can create under our conditions, we can create Markov partitions of these mapping families. And the second thing you mentioned, Arnoux Fischer. So what they did is they just viewed this as, they looked at the geodesic flow on the space of 2D lattices. And they introduced a clever Markov partition. And on this Markov partition, you restack in the Markov way. So what you get then is that your geodesic flow has a Markov partition in which you can see the continued fraction algorithm act. And our goal is to do this for the wild chamber flow in 3D, and we are not completely finished, but it seems that we can code the wild chamber flow by two Brund algorithms, one for each coordinate direction. But I shouldn't boast too much, this is only almost ready.
Okay, that's it.
Yes, welcome to you all. I'm very glad to be here, to be invited by Charlene. It's quite exciting, and I'll tell you why. Because I'm going to tell about... I'm sorry, this is Kor, you know him probably. And Hitoshi, who helped me a lot with doing this. And it's still under construction, actually. But most things are ready now. Five things, it's a bit lot, but it's all very easy for you, so that helps. This is what I saw 1.5 years ago, and it confused me quite a lot. It was one day or 2 days after I met Kor and Hitoshi. I met Hitoshi for the first time, and it was not really meeting, because what I saw was him working with Kor, and they were also confused, and that always relaxes me, because I know two very bright people being confused helps me to feel comfortable. What you see is some diagram. It will return later on. Ah, the pointer. Yeah, I know. I know now. The pointer, no. Yes, there it is. What you see here is we go from 0 to 9, and here also from 0 to 9. You see here a width of 1. So you see here stacked all kinds of unit intervals, and then when you go up to about 7, you suddenly see small gaps and more gaps and larger gaps and larger gaps, and there it stops, because the n expansion I will look at stops at the square root of n. Here n is 100 minus 1. That was all. And it seemed to be quite new. Kor had been working on it with Niels Langefeld, who's here, and whose picture it actually is, because Niels is very clever with computer simulations, and I'm not. And a good thing about computer simulations is that it gives you some impression of what's going on, and on the other hand, probably not, because some things are missing, and you wonder, what are these gaps? So this is the more formal thing of what we've been looking at. It's a well-known continued fraction. It's here the n expansion, and we have chosen alpha between 0, larger than 0, and not larger than the square root of n minus 1. And we have a function from the unit interval unto itself, except for the endpoint alpha plus 1. What we do is we divide this chosen n by an x, x between alpha and alpha plus 1, and we subtract some digit d so as to bring the result between alpha and alpha plus 1 again. So d is defined in that that way. Well, we see some more at these intervals, so you have I alpha and I alpha minus the endpoint. And this is the d, we do it repeatedly, so you have d1, d2, d3, every time you get another number, x, tx, t squared x, etc. And so you get some sort of orbit. Here you get the partial quotient of the n-continued fraction expansions, which is very like the regular continued fractions, for instance. Okay, it's quite new in 2016. Cor and Niels did the first steps in exploring this n-continued fraction for alpha decreasing from square root of n minus 1. Well, here's the orbit. I already mentioned the orbit. Letting x jump somewhere between alpha and alpha plus 1 under t. But as one fixed point for each d, and a fixed point, well, its property is that it doesn't jump. It stays on its place, and it's not very hard to find that it's given by given n square root of 4n plus d squared minus d divided by 2. What's also important is the dividing line, or in the first dimension, the discontinuity point between two cylinder sets. You have, of course, this place where you go from this digit to another digit, and in between you have the discontinuity point. Well, why have we chosen this alpha between the square root of n minus 1 and 0? Because the derivative is minus n divided by x squared, so the derivative on the interval is larger than 1, and that makes the maps expanding and the fixed point repelling. So what you see is a movement from the fixed points away. Well, cylinder set is called full if you reach the whole interval, and when a cylinder set is not full, it contains either alpha or alpha plus 1, and then it's incomplete. I'll give one example of what this t does. With n is 100, alpha is alpha maximum, because the square root of 100 minus 1, and I take a random x, x is 9.82. It looks like this. There you have 9, there you have 10, there you have x, the two fixed points, the discontinuity point, and in this case we have two digits, 1 and 2. So what I do is, where does x go to? Well, the first two steps are there. First, you see the repelling effect from the fixed point over there. It brings that one there, and T9 squared a little bit further, and see after a while it gets forced to go in another compartment where D is 2. Have some more, and then you see after some points you get X5 for the first time there where D is 2, and then X6 there for the first time you need to subtract 2. And then some more points, and what you see happening is that, whoa, I'm sorry. What you see happening is that after a while the red points are the later points in the orbit, and the red points seem to be only in a very small part of the interval alpha until alpha plus 1. And that's actually the case. I have not put any effort in showing where exactly x7, x6, x10, etc. are. What you see is that they are only in a very small part of the interval. Well, what actually happens is they never get out of this of these intervals, and what you get? Yes. Yes. Okay. I'm sorry. Maybe it's better to go back here. So you start at X, and then under. X is this point. I started with the 9.8. Yes. And then we let T work on X. So if T9X on the left. Oh no, I'm sorry. My clumsiness won't disappear during this presentation. I'm sorry. So here's T9X and here's T9X squared, etc. Yeah. And then on the next one, you have.
It goes back and forth.
Yes. Because of the repelling function of the fixed points, the blue dots here. Yes? The blue dots are the fixed points, and the red point there. No, I'm sorry. And the red point is the first time that you need to subtract 2. And I added some points more. Yes, and there you see something developing, and it actually proves to be creating gaps. After a while, you have some gaps, and even in this case, you have a huge gap by at DS1 and a smaller gap by DS2, but the cylinder set there is also smaller. Then I have to define what is actually a gap. It was one of the problems. What is a gap? And we define it as a gap is such that after a while you do not go back in that part of the unit interval. So there must be some n after which you do not come back in the interval. The excluding the fixed point and the pre-images of the fixed point, because obviously they will end in the fixed point and will stay there. So what are the endpoints of these gaps, which is not at all obvious? And in this example, the endpoints of these gaps are actually images of alpha itself. And we'll see this returning later on, that the images of the left point alpha and also alpha plus 1 are very important for determining the gaps. And it's not at all clear now when alpha plus 1 or alpha produces these gaps, and they can also work together. So what I will do now is this. First, I will look at what are sufficient conditions for gaplessness. There are a lot of cases in which you don't have gaps at all. And to give an impression on the complexity of the case, depending on n and alpha, the number of cylinder sets can be very different. At first, the digit is way smaller than n. But as alpha decreases to 1, it changes all. When alpha becomes smaller than 1, d gets larger than n minus 1. And as alpha decreases further until 0, which it shouldn't arrive at, but when it becomes 0, you have the greedy n expansion, which is also quite new and last studied by Kaur and Karma and Niels van der Wecken some years ago. What comes in very handy is the concept of the branch number. What we want is, if we do not have only full branches, full cylinder sets, but only parts of them, and it will become clearer what we have when I take to the two-dimensional case. The branch number is the total amount of complete cylinders added to the incomplete cylinder sets. It becomes all much clearer when it becomes two-dimensional. And the nice thing about this, so we have the number of full cylinders, and the length of the image of the leftmost cylinder and the length of the image of the rightmost cylinder. And when you add them up, you get this very nice expression, n divided by the product of alpha and alpha plus 1. which is a decreasing function of alpha plus 1. And so you see that the branch number increases as alpha decreases. And here you have this formula when you have, when you take alpha the maximum, so the square root of n minus 1. You see it's n plus something, and if something is at least 1, so the number of cylinder sets is always at least 2. Well, here's an important theorem. If n is larger than or equal to 9, and the branch number is larger than or equal to 4, then we don't have gaps. So you say, well, that's for almost all cases you don't have gaps. But what's interesting is what happens when the branch number is smaller than 4, obviously. And the proof of this theorem is not that hard when we can apply the lemma, which I do not prove. If the derivative on the interval is larger than 2, then the interval does not contain any gaps. Because then we can use the branch number. If the branch number is greater than or equal to 4, well, you can do some very easy math. And what you see is that the minimal value of the derivative equals this expression. And that's an increasing function of n and larger than 2 for n greater than or equal to 9. And there we have our result. So we're actually interested mostly in the number of cylinder sets being 2, 3, or 4. But a lot of it is was unknown 1 year ago. So here's a sufficient condition for the absence of gaps in case the branch number is relatively small, so smaller than 4. It's gapless in the following cases if we only have 2 cylinder sets, provided that the image of the left endpoint is at least the left, the right fixed point. Oh no. So this is the right fixed point in the case you have 2 cylinders, and this is the left fixed point. Provided this holds, and if you have more cylinder sets, then only one of those have to hold in order to have gaplessness. Because I want to show a lot about these n expressions, I'm not going to prove any more than I've just did. But now I will focus on these 2 or 3 cylinder sets cases. And to have a much better view of what's going on, I will look now at a two-dimensional representation of these cylinder sets. So, and therefore I will use the same word except sets. So I will look at cylinders, and these are rectangular sets of points in the unit square divided by the dividing lines. So you still have a fixed point, but now a two-dimensional fixed point. And we have now a line as a dividing line between two of these cylinder sets. But the collection of this gamma, as I call it, and its associated branches, fixed points, and dividing lines is an arrangement. And in this arrangement, I will draw cobwebs which reveal the where the gaps are. And I use dotted and dashed. But I also have it in color, so dotted is in green and dashed is in red. And they would color gray the part of this arrangement where you can see where after a while the orbit can only live. So that's sometimes a very small part. Well, one more lemma. When is there a gap in this arrangement? If T alpha is smaller than the right fixed point, and if T alpha plus 1 is larger, well, first one was smaller, and now larger than the left fixed point. Actually, this the problem with pictures like this is that they seem to reveal, they can reveal a lot more, but also can be treacherous, that you see things that are not actually true. This is true, only the gray is very bleak. So Well, I hope you can see the gray. It's between the green lines and the outlines of the square. So what you see, I've taken NS100 alpha by some means. What I did was calculating alpha such that this one ends at the dividing line for some reasons I will reveal later on. And in this case, you see you have two gaps here, a little bit smaller one than I had for alpha's alpha maximum, and here also a bit smaller, but two gaps. And another lemma is a very other arrangement in which you can also have two gaps. In this picture, in this arrangement, you see that both the image of the right endpoint and the image of the left endpoint determine the gaps. But in the next picture, so yeah, it's no use to you can read this, but it shows in the next picture what happens. Here the right endpoint completely determines where the gaps are. So you start here. The green, the cylinder here is very small. No, it's actually, there are only two cylinders here, and you see that's because alpha is F3. And in this case, you see the red web going like this, and you have this very wide gap here, and this very wide gap here. So these are the two cases in which you can have two gaps in the two cylinder case. When I alpha consists of three cylinders, it's all very complicated. You have a huge lot of cases in which there can be gaps or no gaps. You can have three cylinders and no gaps whatsoever, or one gap or two gaps, or even three gaps. And what this lemma states is that here comes in also the importance of the image of alpha and the image of alpha plus one with respect to the fixed points. And what is very important is that the image of the left endpoint, dt alpha alpha, is smaller than fd minus one, and that is smaller than t alpha alpha plus one. And in this case, there's always a gap containing the cylinder in the middle. And that will come to an end, and that's because when alpha decreases, there will be a smallest values in which this condition cannot be fulfilled anymore. And then we come at this picture. And this is what I try to explore. Here, you have the picture in the beginning, the two-dimensional picture in which you have a large gap on the right and a very small gap on the left. And what you cannot clearly see here is that you can actually have three gaps at the same time for the same value of alpha. And here, so, but what you see is that it seems to disappear after a while, which is true. But what you don't see that there's a gap when alpha is 6.6 and a little bit, which is here, and that has to do with that's a very short interval on which you have this gap. So the picture, the computer simulation was a bit helpful to reveal the existence of gaps, and a lot of those, but not everything. So when the branch number is smaller than two, you cannot have more than three cylinder sets. Then you have a really wide variety of arrangements. And to start with, if n is smaller than 33, for alpha is the maximum value, you only have one gap. So only from 33 and larger, you have at the starting point two gaps. When n is large enough, the various type of arrangements will alternate quickly almost immediately once alpha decreased beyond F3. So we saw in four or five pictures before that you only had two cylinders. Now we have three cylinders, but you see the left one is very small. And in this case, something peculiar happens. You see here that the fourth image of the right endpoint is at the dividing line between delta 1 and delta 2. But as alpha decreases even further, you see this fifth image crossing the line. Now it's at even reaching F3. So what you see is that this gap here is crossing the dividing line. So if a gap containing this fixed point, which is crossing the dividing line between this cylinder and that cylinder, and it's still only the right endpoint that limits the gaps. But you also see here, it's very, I think it's doable, but very hard to read. You need the fifth power of having T working on alpha plus 1 to reach all the gaps there are in this case. This is even worse, even nicer, I would say. Here I had to split the gamma. Here I had to split it because this left cylinder is very small indeed. I had to upscale it, and the right one is also very small. What you see here is that both the left endpoint and the right endpoint together define where the gaps are. But you see it's very complicated here. And in between you have one huge gap, but that remains for a long time the same. Well, as alpha decreases further, and the branch number does so as well, the variety in types decreases as well. And after a while, you don't have any gaps left. And I've chosen NS100 because NS100 has a lot of different types, which N has to be at least, I think, 74 or so. And even when you look at NS99, some of the arrangements you can have with NS100, you don't have. What I have done is I made a table with the transitions between all the different arrangements, and with the arrows I indicate where you go from one arrangement to another, and above the arrow I show the number of gaps you have. So I know it's unreadable, but here you start with alpha is 9, then you have two cylinder sets and two gaps. And then when the third image of the left endpoint reaches the second fixed point, there you have only one gap. And then you have two gaps, one gap, two gaps. And after a while, when you have three cylinder sets, you can have three gaps, then two, two, three. And then and you see the index number of the number of cylinders increases, and after a while you lose the possibility of having three gaps. It's the last time, I think. And then you have 1, 2, 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 1, 0. So here we have a case that there's no more gaps left. Then again 1, and it stops when this number is 8. But you see it's filled. So I think you believe it. Okay, I think this is the nicest part, the n-continued fraction in case of gaps. When you have gaps, say m gaps, there's a smallest integer such that, well, the so far image of x does not reach these gaps. And after a while, you can only reach the parts that are not gaps, the gapless parts. And so you get a characteristic part of the orbits in I alpha. It's not a characteristic part of a particular number, but it's a characteristic part of all numbers with this certain arrangement. I have this arrangement Yeah, what you see is you can, here you have only, after a while, this corrected parse, it takes you to F3, only one moment you are in F3, then you go to delta 3, then you go to delta 2, and you can only go from delta 3 via delta 2 to delta 1. Here you can stay for 2, 4, or 6 times, and then you go back to delta 3. So the end continued fraction expansion in case of 3 gaps and 3 cylinders is very much the same for all numbers. Well, I hope you can understand. It's for me too hard and too time-filling to explain, but what's here explains why you can only be not more than 6 time in succession in delta 1. So what's nice is that we have 2 very different numbers, 8.8 and 9.5. And you see after, of course, at the beginning, they're different, 2 to 2, 13 times 1. And after that, you can only have 3, 2, 2, 3, 2, and then an even number of 1s that can only be 2, 4, or 6, 2, 3, 2. And it goes for all numbers between alpha and alpha plus 1. So that's very nice, and that's why it's the characteristic part of the orbit for all numbers in this interval. Okay, well, the computer simulations of Kreyk and Langefeld, which I'm very grateful for, of course, but they suggest all kinds of things which are not true. Also that there are only gaps when you have 2 or 3 cylinder sets. And last year, we thought, yeah, that makes sense, because when you have 4 or more cylinder sets, you have 2 complete cylinder sets. And when you have 2 complete cylinder sets, you map all things onto each other, so you cannot have gaps. And I tried to prove it for several months, until I thought, well, it's obvious that it's true, but suppose it's not true, well, you all know it, I guess. And after a while, I felt, maybe it's not true, but hey, that would mean a huge gap. And I thought, it cannot be true, but well, I'm not very good in giving suspense. It is true, but not always. It's only a small part of all numbers which have 4 cylinders and still have gaps. So the ones nearest to 100 are for NS 83 and 109. And what you need is very narrow cylinders, and well, it's not very hard to construct those. What I did actually is I asked someone who's good with computers, can you run through? And I thought the numbers have to be very high. And I was a bit disappointed when I found out that it works for NS 11 and 10 and 9 even. But I didn't know where to look. And it looks like this. In the first picture, you have an extremely small delta 4. And you see the gap is huge. And the funny thing is that you have a gap that's including both fixed points F2 and F3. And when we thought about it, we thought, how could that be possible? But it is possible. And here's its 2. And what you see here, the interval from here to here, of course, I've taken a picture like this because alpha is decreasing. But from here to here, that's the only period that the huge gap can exist. And this number we call the lower alpha, alpha L, and alpha upper. And you can only have a gap when alpha lower is smaller than or equal to alpha upper. Equal does not occur. So here's alpha upper and alpha lower. And the funny thing is that while the fixed numbers are repellent in a cylinder, in this case you see a contraction between the two full cylinders. And you see, if you have a value that's not between alpha lower and alpha upper, you see actually a contraction to the fixed points when you keep moving between 2 cylinders. And once you've reached one cylinder, of course, the fixed points are repellent again. Well, these are the cases that you do have gaps when n is 2k squared plus 2k minus I, with k having these values 1, 2, and 3. And it's very narrow, that, with which I want to say that here, when n is 9, you do have a gap, but when n is 8, you don't have a gap, because alpha lower is larger than alpha upper. But when you see here for n is 56, for instance, it's a very close call that you don't have a gap, and here you see it's incredibly small. So for a very short period, you do have a gap when n is 57. And of course, these are very small numbers yet, so imagine what happens when n becomes really large. Well, when the number of cylinder sets is 5 or more, the branch number will soon be larger than 4, and we already saw that when the branch number is larger than 4 and n is larger than 9 or equal to, then you don't have gaps. So we only have very few cases to calculate, but we already know that they don't have gaps whatsoever. So that was everything I have to say about n-continued fraction expansions. Thank you for your attention.
So, questions for Jaap. Wolfgang.
Have you considered the similar questions for minus beta transformations? So, or in particular maps minus beta x plus alpha modulo 1? It should be, could
no.
be quite similar. No,
no I really have told everything I know.
So, so I wonder if the shape of the map, it's of an importance here, or it's just important that the map is monotonic on intervals.
Okay. I'm sorry, Cora is being a bit impatient, which it doesn't show for me to finally finish this research to go into questions like these. But this appeared to be way harder than we thought. Actually, Cora thought this is a nice bachelor project. And well, when I saw Hitoshi and Cora working on it, I already thought, well, that's quite a hard bachelor project. So we didn't. We have not reached anything further than this.
And another question is the reason to look only to restrict n to natural numbers and instead of real numbers.
There's no reason except that it's better than looking at only n is 1. So the next step would be real numbers. I'm sorry. It's really. I have nothing to add.
Okay, more questions? Can you give an indication of what the importance of the gaps is and how big the gaps are? I mean, what does it imply for example, for Diophantine approximation or how well behaved this continued fraction is? Because there are several parameters, right? There's the n, there's the alpha.
Yeah.
And okay, so I fix an n and I fix an alpha. What is the importance of the size of the gaps in your...
Well, the problem is, and really I'm not too happy about that, but we know very little still. We don't know anything about measure preserving, for instance, or the natural extension or anything. So we're really...
Yeah, I thought Robert would ask about natural extensions.
He's gone already.
He is there.
Oh, no. He's falling asleep. So ask the question, Robert.
No.
And so the answer is you don't know anything about the natural extension in general. Right. Okay. So that means. Let me give you the microphone, and you can.
I think it is relevant for the invariant measure that's absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue. That's the support. Yeah. So the gaps are outside the support. Yeah. So
if there are no gaps, which seems to be the general case, then...
Yeah, then the support will be the whole interval. Yeah.
Yeah, I only look for gaps, actually.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any more questions? If not, let's thank Jaap once more. Okay. Thank you. Then we have a break until 11:15, and let me remind you that at 2:30 this afternoon there's an opportunity to visit the library of the Scuola Normale.
So, okay, yeah, I will quickly explain also why I want to speak about Rosen continued fractions. So the core invited me to come to Delft for 1 month in 2005. And then, okay, then I learned a lot of things about continued fractions, as you might guess, and also about natural extensions. Robert is gone now, it's a pity. Huh? So whenever you want to need an approximation property of continued fractions, of course, so CoRE will tell you, oh, look at the natural extension, here it is. So that's how you get it. And well, Hitoshi could also tell you these things. okay, so it's give it. I have to give it to pass it on to somebody else after. So when you have a question like that, please ask CoRE. He will be very happy to explain it to you. If you don't ask him, he will explain you. if you want to ask or know something about dynamical properties, you should of course ask Karma. Okay, so first, what we wanted to study was something like Julien Bernard defined some beta continued fractions, which were a mixture of beta expansions and of continued fractions. And so when I arrived at Delft, so Wieb and CoRE and Karma were studying them, but somehow it's difficult to say something about them, so I will not say anything about them. So I learned only in the last week that some Chinese guys, they have now some host of dimension results on them. So, but apart from that, there seems to be no improvement for them. So that then when we couldn't study these, so we looked at alpha Rosen continued fractions, so together with Karma and CoRE. So how are they defined? So it's a map T alpha, which depends on alpha and lambda, some lambda. So it goes from alpha minus lambda, to itself. So here again, that's not enough. You should take an interval. Here I included the endpoint alpha, and it's defined by x goes to the absolute value of 1 over x minus the integer multiple of lambda, which is just the one you need to come back to this interval. So in our paper we divided alpha by lambda, but I think it's perhaps more convenient not to do it. And so alpha should be between 1 and minus lambda and 1, so that this interval is contained in minus 1, 1. It's a generalization of two things. First, if you take alpha equals first, if you take lambda equals 1, and if then you get Hitoshi Nakada's alpha expansions, and in particular for alpha equals 1/2, you get the nearest integer continued fractions, and for alpha equals 1, you get the regular continued fractions. And if you take more generally lambda equals 2 cosine of pi over q, where q is an integer larger or equal to 3. Okay, and if you take alpha equals lambda half, then you get Rosen continued fractions, which were defined by Rosen in 1954. So he considered one of his aims was to consider the word problem on Hecke groups. So what is a Hecke group? The group GQ, which depends on this parameter Q, is the group generated by the two matrices 1, 0, lambda 1, and 0, 1, minus 1, 0. So if you call that one S and that one T, you have two relations. The one is obviously T squared is the identity. And the other relation is that if you multiply S times T and take it to the Q of power, then you also get the identity. So this is S times T, something like a rotation by 2 pi over Q. So elliptic rotation. Okay, so there's so if you want to know more about Hecke groups, ask Tom Schmidt, and he will tell you on Friday something about similar groups and more general ones. Huh? Okay, so special cases. So if you take Q equals 3, then you have lambda equals 1. So you go back to the regular case. If you take Q equals 4, you take lambda equals square root of 2. Q equals 5, lambda is the golden ratio. And Q equals 6, lambda is square root of 3. And then afterwards you get algebraic numbers that are not of higher degree, not quadratic. Okay, so when in 2000, Burton, Kurt Kreukamp, and Tom Schmidt, they looked at the natural extension for the case alpha equals lambda half, and then so with Karma. And core, so we considered the more generally the case that lambda half is so alpha is between lambda half and 1. That's because if you go to the left, then you the things become much more complicated, as is well known for the case lambda equals 1. What we did is we constructed the natural extension for these cases. So how does what's a natural extension first? How do you define it? So we have this map T alpha, and we want to extend it, which is of course not injective. We want to make a bijective map out of it by adding a second coordinate. So in the first coordinate, it's this map curly T alpha is equal to T alpha, and in the second coordinate, it's equal to 1 over sine of x times. Is this correct? times y plus the digit of x times lambda. So what is the digit? It's this one. So you can see this these things as Möbius transformations. So you can write it as to make it go. This is d minus d alpha of x lambda
sine of x 1, 0 applied to x and 0, 1 sine x d alpha of x times lambda times y, where A, B, C, D, dot x is the Möbius transformation AX plus B over CX plus D. So here, this matrix is A, then this matrix is the transpose of A to the minus 1, if you put the minus signs are not important here, of course. That's a very general construction of the natural extensions, of natural extension maps for continued fractions. And you can now, it acts on some domain, omega alpha, which you can define as so you iterate this map on points x0, where you take all points in the interval, for example. Or it's also enough to take in a generic point for that. And then take the closure of that. So if you take this to the definition, it's not difficult to see that you have T alpha of omega alpha is equal to omega alpha, up to measure 0. And it's also bijective. Up to a set of measure 0. So which measure? Well, the Lebesgue measure or the invariant measure for this is given by d mu. Can you see that? Or should I? Is equal to dx dy over 1 plus xy squared, which is of course equivalent to Lebesgue, if you avoid a certain line. Then if you to get the probability invariant measure, you have to normalize that, but otherwise it already, this is invariant. A natural extension is something, that's from one coordinate, it's the same as the map itself, and it's bijective. So you have a nice measure on it, which is then all this is easy. Well, one problem is now to see how this domain looks like. And the first problem is, of course, to see that the measure of omega alpha is actually larger than 0. So this is, if you have a measure 0, then it must, it would not make a lot of sense. So sometimes this is easy, sometimes this is difficult. Let me give some examples of the. So the simplest case is, of course, lambda equals 1 and alpha equals 1. Then the natural extension is just the full rectangle. And it's mapped to itself because if you take stripes like that, then this stripe is mapped to this. And this stripe is mapped here. And so on. And what we did with Core and Karma is to give this a natural extension in general, and for the domain that I described, they'll always look like that. So you have alpha minus lambda alpha, and then you have some
some steps, and it's what a nice shape. So it's just you have only you have a finite union of rectangles, and if you go from alpha, you could go to the left of lambda half, then you get a lot of complicated things. That's that's for lambda equals one. That's what we did in described in a paper by with Korant and Tom, and so Core likes to do it with quilting afterwards. But I'm not good at quilting, so I did it more. I would rather do it differently. So what are these points here? So these points where the you have these jumps. They can be easily described because you have. Okay, let me put this definition here. So if you say LK are the images of the left endpoint, and RK are the images of the right endpoint. Here you have R0, L0, and all these points are images of the endpoints. And one of the results in the paper with Koh and Karma was that so if Q is even, Q is this. Okay, I should have bound that also here. Lambda is equal to 2 cosine of pi over Q. If Q is even, then you have what is now called matching. So L after times Q over 2. So L Q over 2 is equal to R Q over 2. If Q is odd, then you have two different cases. So first, if you take lambda half, so alpha between lambda half and something which I called rho, which is equal to lambda minus 2 plus square root of lambda squared minus 4 lambda plus 8 over 2, and which is, if you take lambda equals 1, this is the golden mean, then you have LQ minus 1 is equal to RQ minus 1, and if you take alpha between rho and 1, you have something a bit more complicated. So L, here you have the floor of Q2, and it's equal to R, the ceiling Q of 2. So here's a difference of 1 here in this exponents. So what are these points here? So if you have something like Lm equals Rn, then the pre-matching, what is called pre-matching set. So here, if this happens, if we say we have pre-matching, and if the pre-matching set P alpha is all the points, all the iterates that before you have matching. So let me be a bit more precise here. So here you want that that Lm is equal to some matrix A, which is a product of such matrix, these matrices times of A minus lambda, and Rn is equal to B times alpha, and so we want that A times 1 minus lambda 0 1 is equal to B. So that really have this holds because you have equality of matrices here. And so what does the pre-matching set give us for the natural extension? it tells us that if you define psi alpha x, if you have x here, then it's the fiber, so that's the this line here, the line which is contained in my set omega alpha. So that's the set of y's such that x, y is contained in omega alpha. And now if you take an interval, if you take 2 points x and say z, and you look at those two fibers, and so if there's no point in the matching set in between them, like here, then these fibers are equal. So if you have a finite pre-matching set and you also know that there are intervals, then it's quite easy to determine the shape of the natural extension. If they're not intervals, then it gets more complicated. And if you have no matching, then it's also more complicated, of course. So we want to say a bit more about natural extensions. So of course, one good thing you can read off from the natural extension, it's the invariant measure of the original map of T alpha. So you have, for example, so you have T nu is in the integral over psi. You can just have to integrate over psi alpha the map T mu, the invariant measure of the natural extension. Another thing about natural extensions that I like very much, but which holds only for lambda equals one, is that you actually get from it the purely periodic expansion, so that the sets of points that have purely periodic alpha expansion. So you have the following: by purely periodic I mean that t alpha to the n of x is equal to x for some n larger than one. So this holds if and only if x and the point and if x should be quadratic and so this point x and minus 1 over x prime, which is x prime is the conjugate of x, is in the natural extension domain. So this is of course well known if alpha equals 1. If we have a complicated natural extension domain, this is tells you that this set of purely periodic points, they can really be complicated. I don't see how to describe them in another way than using the natural extension. Unfortunately, this doesn't. I don't think there's a way to generalize this to other lambda, because if you're a lambda, then they are quadratic over q lambda, and so you don't have one conjugate, but more conjugates. So it's yes.
Can you use this to draw the natural? Periodic point will be dense. So can you use this characterization to draw the actual shape of omega alpha?
Yes, but this would be probably yes. Yeah. But this would be of course a complicated. So to make computer experiments, for computer experiments, of course, there's a much simpler way, of course, which is just taking any random point and iterate this map. And what I find quite surprising is that you always get somehow the right shape. It doesn't matter what point you take, what starting point x zero you take. If you iterate it, then you get the right shape. So somehow these errors made by the computer, because of this 1/x, they all cancel out, and you always. So if there someone has an explanation for that, I would also be interested. It might be interesting. Yeah. Okay, so it should speed up a bit, perhaps. Okay, so now this was basically the story of our paper, and then okay, you could say then, for example, that the natural extension is weakly Bernoulli, and what? Okay. So for okay, then for lambda equals one, then the people, a lot of people have looked at what happens to the left of 1/2 for alpha left 1/2. So starting with Laura Lutz and Stefano Marmi, and then of course Hitoshi Nakada and Rie Natsui. So we have a paper with Kor and Tom, and then there's of course a lot of papers by Carlo and Giulio, and their co-authors from a lot of them from here, so Marmi, Profeti, Bonanno, Isola. So what they were interested in was then the entropy of these maps, and they found okay, here we're still in the case lambda equals one, and they found that okay, so it was known of course between square root of three minus square root of 5/2. This is also a bit difficult, but it's constant between square root of 3 minus square root of 2 and square root of 5/2. It was known here between until 1, and then here if we go down to 0, it's very complicated. And we still don't know if this is the maximum. One thing we also found in the paper with Kor and Tom was that the entropy multiplied about with the measure of omega alpha, so this is the non-normalized measure, is always constant, so it's pi squared over 6. But this seems also to be specific to this kind of map with lambda equals 1. From matching, of course, you have this formula about so within a matching interval, you have the formula that the entropy of T alpha prime is equal to the entropy of T alpha divided by 1 plus n minus m times the measure, so non-normalized of what do we have to put here, alpha minus 1, alpha prime minus 1. If alpha is less than alpha prime, and you're in a matching interval with Lm equals Rn. So you know, depending on the m and the n, if the entropy decreases, or is constant. So there were now people to replace this one by minus 1/x. So for lambda equals 1. So this was mainly done by Svetlana Katok and Uka Kovici. And then also studied by Carlo and Giulio, and also Tom Schmidt with Max Scheingorn in 1905. They studied the map x goes to minus 1/ x what minus no what's that thing? So I hope this is correct, minus 1/ x lambda. Okay, so this is perhaps even more natural from the point of view of Rosen, of the Hecke groups. But still, so I decided for this talk now to concentrate on this. I mean, because so already in, I think 10 years ago when I met Tsutoshi Nakada in Delft, and we looked at this and we found some matching properties, but we never written it up. And then some years ago, Niels Langefeld and Carlo Cominati, they started studying at it, and so now we will perhaps publish something about this soon for lambda. So for lambda equals one. But so now for when I prepared the talk, I should thought that okay, maybe you can do it for Rosen, and so that's what I'm I will speak now in the rest of the talk. 15 minutes. Okay, so the first one who looked at this. So let me erase this. This map for lambda equals one was defined by Tanaka and Ito. And Ito in 1981, the same year that Hitoshi Nakada published his paper on Hissner alpha expansions. So I don't know why Tanaka is here in the first author, but and so what they found the following. So they looked also at 1/2 alpha between. They found two matching intervals. The one is 1/2 to. So here you should say that for this map, the alpha you have that. That minus t alpha of x is equal to t lambda minus alpha over minus x. So it's so you only have to consider 1/2 of the interval, because the other half is given by this this conjugation between two maps. So if you take this 1/2, so here you find one interval with where you have L2 equals R2, and here you have L3 equals R3, and then it gets complicated. So here, to say why this holds, so here you have, so in this case you have alpha minus 1 is can be written as minus 2, and the continued fraction is d plus 1 L2. So this is the. So this means that this is 1 over minus 2 plus 1 over d plus 1 plus L2. And alpha equals 2 d R2. So, and then you can, from this relation, you can easily get that L2 is equal to R2. And here you have something a bit longer. So you have, alpha minus 1 is equal to minus 3 2 L3, and alpha is equal to minus 2 minus 3 d plus 1 R3, and okay, you get so then these two intervals easy, and then afterwards it gets complicated. Let me first speak about what happens in the next interval in the here. So if you take alpha larger than the square root of 5 minus 1 over 2, then you have R1 is 1 over alpha minus 1, and you have the following relation. You have that 1 over L0 plus 1 over R1 plus 1 is equal to 0. So now, if you have such a relation that 1 over x plus 1 over y is an integer, then you immediately get that the image of the image that is right, that the sum is an integer, and if you this also holds, of course, so if you can put lambda here, because the alpha of x is just, okay, 1 over x minus an integer, the alpha of y is 1 over y minus an integer. And so you only have two possibilities, and it's in some interval, so in fact you get it can only be 0 or lambda. So if you're 0, then you're in the same situation again. So if you have, okay, sorry, so if x plus y is equal to 0, then you have okay, that's the two things. Now you're in a situation that x plus y is equal to 0, which of course implies that 1 over x plus 1 over y is equal to 0, if they are non-zero, but out of 0, the case of 0 is easy to treat. And then so you can iterate it. So you always have the relation that x plus y is equal to 0, or x plus y is equal to lambda, if you look at the iterates of the left-hand point and the right-hand point. And what happens now if x plus y is equal to lambda, let's do it first for equal to 1, and then lambda equals, again, lambda equals to 1, then you have two cases. If x is large, which means that t alpha of x is equal to 1 over x minus 1 or minus lambda, then you get the relation that t alpha squared of x is equal to t alpha of y. So you have matching. You have found that the iterates of L 0 and R 0, that if you run through this, and if at some point this happens, we have the relation that the sum is lambda and x is large, then you have then you found matching with a difference of 1 here, 1 between the x and y, and if it's as you can suppose, of course, that x is larger equal than y, and if x is small, then you have the alpha of x is 1 over x minus 2 lambda. I should make it for lambda equals 1 now, and the alpha of y is also 1 over y minus 2. And you get, what do you get then? You find that 1 over t alpha of x plus 1 over t alpha of y plus 1 is equal to 0. So and you're again in this case as before. So then the next step you have x plus. So you only have three possibilities for these behaviors of the two. And so if at some point you're here and the x is large, then you have found the matching. And this is something that happens with probability 1. So up to a set of measure 0. So more precisely, we got the following description of the bifurcation set, or say the matching set, which is the union of all matching intervals. So the number of all points where this matching happens, this is I'll write it only on the interval G1 restricted to G1. This is the whole interval minus the set of points alpha in G1, such that if you Okay, now we get, okay, you can either give a definition with respect to alpha the alpha continued fraction map, which is not very handy because you have a different map for each alpha. You can also get a description in terms of the TG, so the T1 of the golden ratio map. But you also even get one with the regular continued fraction map, which is probably for most people easiest to study. Okay, you never get matching if you're never in the set 1 over alpha plus 1 alpha, in the interval 1 over plus alpha plus 1, yeah, for all n large and 2, or T1 to the n of alpha is not in in some different set, okay, 1 minus alpha, alpha over alpha plus 1. And then there's a small additional condition, which is some value plane alpha is odd, which I don't shall define it here. Okay, let me quickly write it. Pn alpha is the minimum of those k such that T1 to the n minus k of alpha is less or equal than minus 1 over alpha, or T1 to the n minus k minus 1 of alpha is larger or equal than alpha. So it's a bit complicated description. It's easier, it's more complicated than for Nakata's alpha expansion, where Carlo and Giulio showed that the similar set, so this, you, these are the equivalent set was T1 to the n of alpha larger or equal alpha for all n. So there's a difference now between this set. So here we had that for Nakata's alpha expansion, we had that whenever all rationals lie in, so no rational lies in here, because for a rational you always get to zero at some point. And but here now we can have rationals where rational numbers where we don't have matching. And yeah, so other properties that are similar to Nakata's alpha expansion. Okay, so also, okay, the matching set has full measure, and but the exceptional set has Hausdorff dimension 1, and so with Niels and Carlo and perhaps Hitoshi, we get also results on other Hausdorff dimension results. Okay, so I have very little time to speak about the general case now. Okay, so let me just mention some results. So if Q is even, Q is even, then there are two different cases. Either Q is congruent to 2 mod 4. The first one is that Q is congruent 2 mod 4, or alpha is small. Which can be quantified, of course, where you have LQ over 2 is equal to RQ over 2. This is just the same as for the alpha Rosen continued fractions with the absolute value. And then there's another case, so this Q is congruent 0 mod 4 and alpha large, where LQ minus 1 is equal to RQ minus 1. And I think in all that cases, you have the shape of the natural extension domain is a nice system, some staircase. Staircase on top and below, because we have also negative digits now. So what can I say about Q odd? So we are a bit in a similar, okay. So let me write this up there. Q odd. We're in a similar situation like there, but of course now the the constants, this is a difference. The points are different. But so if alpha is small, we have again LQ minus 1 is equal to RQ minus 1. Then then in the immediate case, okay, this is so on to the right, if alpha is large, we have something like we have LP plus I didn't define P. Q is equal to 2P plus 3. You have LP plus 1 plus P plus 2 is either is 0 or lambda. And then you can do pretty much the same machinery as for the case lambda equals 1. So you also get, then afterwards it's pretty similar. So you have a lot of different behaviors. In fact, the behaviors here, the difference between m and n is always is either 0 or 2. And in here, there's another distinction between between p is even. Then you have then you have r case, then they match at some point for some k, but the case, I think it's not uniform on the whole interval. And if p is odd, then you have a much more complicated behavior. Then you have rk is equal to minus 1 to the n of lk plus 1. And so I think n can be arbitrary. So you have some subintervals where, for some k, for some n and some k. And so you have some intervals where you have subintervals here where you have matching immediately. You have some other subintervals where you have something like that. And then you have, again, a lot of subdivisions. Okay, thank you very much.
We have time for a quick question.
What's your guess for the Hausdorff dimension of the bifurcation set in this case?
Guess for the Hausdorff dimension of the bifurcation set.
Yeah, it should always be 1. But so in the even case it's 0, Q even it's 0, in Q odd it should always be 1. Yeah.
It should be more complicated than the Lagrangian or similarly as complicated.
I think there's a. For lambda equals 1, so which is Q equals 3, then we know that it's the Hausdorff dimension is 1, and there's, I think for others, since we have the very similar behavior, it should be the same.
Can I make another comment? Which is maybe I did it last year after Tom's talk in the Netherlands, but it's similar. So if you take negative 1 over x instead of plus 1 over x, this is related, it's better related to geometry because you have orientation preserving and everything. In particular, if you do lambda equals 1, then you get bifurcation set is basically Sturmian sequences, and those are related to simple closed geodesics on the punctured torus. And I suspect if lambda is another number, then instead of the punctured torus, you would have another surface, like you would have a 2 Q infinity triangle group. So then you probably could ask whether the bifurcation set for that case would be related to coding of geodesic on this other surface. I guess Tom is probably the best person to be interested in this question, but I think it's a nice question for anyone who wants to think about it. Okay.
Yeah, so as I said, I've discovered that, but since the talk, I thought initially I would speak only about the case lambda equals 1, because it's the only new, the only non-studied case. And then, since it's quite relatively simple, so now in the last 2 weeks or so, I looked at this this for lambda, for more general lambda. And then it's only recently thought, okay, maybe minus 1 over x would have been better. Yeah, I agree.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let's thank Wolfgang again and all the speakers of this morning session. And let me remind you that if you want to visit the library, you should be back here at 2:30. And tomorrow morning you can sleep in as long as you're back here at 9:30 for Valerie's talk. Okay, see you tomorrow.